Please join me in welcoming to the stage Byron Velasco, Ryan O'Connell, and Nick Jonas.
Find these tapes in the back of Blockbuster next to Face of the Death. And I was just really interested in the people that would do it, that would do something that we all try to avoid, which is violence. Yeah. And so I thought about it for many, many years and never really pitched it anywhere because it just was that kind of thing where when you brought it up, people sort of glaze over because it sort of seems lowbrow or something like that. So initially I just got to a place where I just wrote it. And, so I can show people that it's about the characters and the people.
So, yeah, I want to mention Blockbuster, so this is really an old idea. So we wrote the script, like, what was the pitching process like? We're like, we're not just like, we love it! They're like, maybe it's okay with golfers instead!
Well...
We're like, we love it, we got it, we just, I don't know, like, let's make them all think golf and, like, drama about the golf.
Yeah, so I tried that. I did that. Yeah, this wasn't one I pitched. I just wrote the script and then sold the script and then in the mall studio had a hell of a time finding somebody willing to put it on there. So they shielded me from all the rejection until I heard yes. So
wow, and yeah. Like BB supported the, like the creative direction, like
yeah,
absolutely. You feel like protected, like you can be your own. Too much.
100%. We really have a lot of freedom, and we do exactly what we want, what we feel like the story needs to be, and can take chances and experiment. Not only in scripts, but then when we get on set, we want to try something, then we do it.
My God, wow, that's medium raw.
Yes. Wow. Absolutely.
Okay, I'm gonna know what the writer's room is like because I'm in a writer's room and it's usually just a lot of people eating M&M's, getting 15 pounds in 4 months, and not knowing about anything about sports. So I'm wondering like what kind of cast of characters you assembled to write for the show. Is it people connected to sports or MMA at all, or like, you know?
No, nobody really connected to MMA in the writer's room because we have an MMA like technical advisor. We have great coaches, Greg Jackson, who's one of the top trainers in the world, and Joe Daddy Stevenson, who's on set with us every day. So, you know, that stuff can get taken care of. So I really need writers that can tell character stories. And so that's what we focus on there.
Yeah, that's Yeah, so do you ever like pitch something to the MMA technical advisors and they're like, that's MM Craig, that's not accurate.
Go back, I try to make sure I don't come up to them looking like a dumbass. You know? So I spend a lot of time trying to figure it out, and then I go to them and I say, I want to do this, I'm trying to get the character here, how do I make this feel, you know, not ridiculous.
So you're the showrunner of the show, which means people who don't know showrunners, it means they're the big boss applesauce. And I want to know what your
demand to be called.
You should actually call
just applesauce.
I'm the boss applesauce.
Just applesauce.
And then just put down a thing of applesauce in the script. Let's start eating.
I don't like the script. I pour applesauce on it. Hand it back to him.
Who am I? I'm the boss. And point the applesauce all over the script. I love that. You should tell me that. So, I want to know what your favorite part of showrunning is.
Glory.
The money, too.
Yeah. The money and the glory and the access. Really, the best part of it is getting to be in charge of the vision of the show and getting to make the show that I want to make, you know? Because there's a lot of different variables that go into making a show and making it what you hope it's going to be. So if you get a chance to control as much of that as you can, or at least have a say in it, that's probably the best
part. Have you thought compromise in the past with the things that you want to do?
Oh, hell yeah.
So now
Anytime you're working in a studio system or a network system, you know, there's a lot of different reasons people are making a show, and they have a lot of agendas that they have to meet. So, you know, by its nature, it's going to be compromised in the sense that it's for broad appeal. This show that we're making, it's really just about the show. There's no edict to make it mainstream. Or broad. I mean, we hope everybody likes it, but it's more important for it to be good.
So it's like the purest creative process you've had, probably, right?
Yeah.
Love that. Yeah. What is your least favorite aspect of showrunning?
My physical decline.
Are years being deleted off your life?
Yeah, years get deleted off your life. You don't see, your scope of focus is very narrow. You don't do anything but this. But it's fun, so.
Yeah, well, you know, you guys got 20 episode order this season, which is double per season, which is major. So part of you was probably like, yay! And you're like, I'm not gonna have a life for a very long time. Yeah. Do you have a family?
I have a wife.
Have you seen her in months?
I have seen her.
Text me before the show, just like, talk. Can you talk?
Yeah, we sleep in the same house, so I see her all the time back there. At night, and then she got a little part in the show. She played Shelby, who's one of the girls that works at the gym. So I get to see her work sometimes.
God, who did she fuck to get that part?
I'm just joking.
So the show is pretty dark. It's dark. It's a dark family. I would not want to be in this family. They're scary. They fight a lot and they get angry.
Yeah.
We get beat up a lot. I'm wondering, like, what is the mood like on set? Is the set like, you know, is the set like, how do you keep it light? Like, you need to keep it light, right? Or do people need to like, be angry all the time?
Well, I would say, despite what you saw in these trailers, there is like a lot of humor in the show. And he is kind of, fucked up as the family is. There's a lot of love there, you know what I mean? And then just as a cast and everybody that makes the show, we're all really close and really like to be around each other. So there's a lot of competition and a lot of like good nature, you know, just atmosphere on set.
I imagine there's a lot of testosterone.
There's a little bit.
Right? Yeah. Like, cool it, bro. Time out.
Yeah, sometimes we have to do that.
So. Really?
Yeah,
sometimes we have to
do that.
Oh, boys, it's so much fun.
Yeah. Yeah. It's rambunctious.
Wow. I want to know what the response in that MMA world has been like. I mean, assume they use Twitter sometimes. Do MMA fighters tweet and be like, hashtag not accurate, hashtag my life?
No, we get hashtag goosebumps, hashtag my life, hashtag lol. But we've been really embraced by the MMA community because we use the top people in the sport to help us make the show. So all of our background are real fighters. We use real fighters to fight guys like Nick. Like I said, our tech advisors, very famous MMA coach. We're working with Black Owl Steve down in Bergen, who's really big gym. So we're very authentic. So that was the big fear, is like, you don't want to make a show that these guys and girls are going to think it's lame.
Yeah, and then you fought a real fighter. How were you scared?
A little bit. And it's incredibly intimidating. Just first of all, the training aspect of it. We work with some of the most talented and professional fighters in the world. Mm-hmm. And you know, with that comes a really high level of respect from all of us, and a hope that we can look authentic. And so we all push ourselves pretty hard in that way. Frankly, we should have had a background in fighting previously, so we had to jump in and kind of play catch up. But my first fight was in the second week of shooting. At the time, the number three fighter in the world. Amazing guy, this guy, Gus Swanson, who probably saw that. But, you know, if you're off by just a centimeter, it can end pretty badly. Jonathan Tucker took an elbow to the face in one of his fights and started bleeding, just put a crazy glue on it and kept shooting. So there's a real commitment to making this thing feel real and give it all we have.
Have you had a real injury on set?
I've been lucky. I took one kick from Cub that landed right in the chest and kind of knocked the wind out of me.
Yeah.
And then, you know, just natural sort of bruising and getting beat up over time. But it's fun. I love it. I grew up with brothers, so it's every day.
But you did grow up with brothers? Where were you at emotionally, physically, and spiritually when you first heard about Kingdom? Were you good at acting, or were you like, well, he's like, it's the only thing for me?
It was a really interesting time in my life. I was about 2 months after the closing of the chapter with my brothers. I was living in New York at the time, trying to figure out exactly what I wanted to do. I had a couple acting projects, more so in the musical world, where I started as a kid. And then I just had finished a show called How to Succeed in Business, so I was trying a lot of way. And, you know, I wanted to find more projects that I could dive into on the acting front that weren't just a one or two episode arc. And looked through a bunch of material. One of the first things I read was came at the time, it was called Navy Street. And I called my agent and I said, look, you know, I would love to do all I can just to get room to read for this. And you have to understand that at this time, there was a lot of bias, I think, just towards my previous exposure and previous projects, which is understandable, coming from where I came from with my brothers. I'm very aware of that. I'm the kind of person that kind of takes it on head on, as opposed to trying to ignore it, because you know, they were big obstacles. So I finally got an audition, which was a struggle alone. And was kind of told me, we got you the audition, but just don't get your hopes up, because they're really specific about the tone of the show, they want to feel like it. I got a call back, and test with Frank and Byron's there. It came at a really interesting time, changed my life, and I think the fight that I was dealing with internally about not knowing what my steps were going to be in my career, my life, and not wanting to be washed up at 21 years old. I had to work really hard, both physically and emotionally, but was so thankful for the casting of the show and that I had the opportunity to dive in like this. And it opened me up creatively on many levels, both in the acting space, but also music. A great couple years since then.
Yeah, I'd say you transitioned quite nicely. You certainly showed your rest, you thought who was boss. You're like, don't get your hopes up.
Yeah.
You're like, I need something good past it. You're just fine. Oh my god.
Yeah.
And in fact, when you heard that Nick was in audition, were you like, lol, no? Or like, were you like, what was that?
I didn't say lol. I think it was more of like an F no. But that was my own narrow-minded bullshit. I got schooled pretty quick when he came in, and I was like, oh shit, he's good. And then still, and I was hesitant, because again, we're making a show about fighters. I only knew Nick vaguely from his past career. And so I was just scared, you know. I was worried that coming out of the gate, I was worried what the perception was going to be and all that kind of stuff, naively. But he kept coming back, and he kept distancing himself from everybody else. So then, at that point, you're just an asshole if you don't pass the best guy. So, you know, Nick nailed it, and I said, let's do it.
Was anyone hesitant? Like, was Brett to be like, I don't know, and then, like, or were you just like...
No, we all just had the same questions, because Nick, again, like Nick said, he's just coming out of this thing. So the questions were, how much does he want to really do this? How committed is he? And we know that this show is going to be raw and visceral, and we're going to have to do, you know, we don't hold anything back. Is he going to want to do it? And Nick, to his credit, said, I'm doing everything. And he wanted to disappear into it. Once I saw him with Frank and some of the other cast, it was just perfect and on too.
Yeah, for your first serious acting role, you certainly don't fuck around. You're like, like sometimes some people like please into it, you know, but I don't know, maybe I'll play like someone who used to be in a boy band. But you were like, no, I'm gonna be a sexually confused fighter with team 15 pounds of muscle and like fight everybody.
That's exactly what I thought.
Yeah. Wait, the show is like very mask. Like I watched all of them. Like mask show. Yeah, I'm not that
thing.
Like, you know, it's not that, you know, whatever.
What is that?
Mask means
mask. Oh, mask.
Yeah, and I hope you're on records researching the show. Yeah. See, it's starting to hurt a little bit, isn't it?
Jeez. Oh, you're broken. Broken in a little bit.
Yeah, okay. So,
don't say no, say yes.
So, when you were developing the show, and you were thinking about the characters you wanted to be in, why did you choose to include someone who was wrestling with sexuality?
Well, because a lot of the characters I like to write about characters that are struggling with their identity and where they fit in the world. And I like to try to do that in various different avenues. And you know, I think the MMA world, as much as it's coming into the mainstream, is still a very mass world. That is, that's rooted in a lot of, it's macho and combat, and, you know, there's a lot of perhaps repressed violence and or other things going on. So. For me, it was a great way to explore sort of a guy trying to come to terms with his identity and figure out where he fits in the world.
Has there been, I should know this, has there been any out, are there any out MMA fighters?
Not that, I can't say there's not any, but I don't think there, I do not know of any at a high level that are openly out.
Has anyone like reached out to me like, it's me? So, Nick, what kind of cover did you, like, you know, do this part? Do you go on Grindr? I mean, like, what?
Grindr's storyline is fairly new. But, I mean, for the character as a whole, I think the thing that Byron was talking about is kind of the way I approach it is we're dealing with real life, you know, human issues and life, and struggle for identity was real for me in my own sort of journey with this, because it was a major change in my life, in my world, more so with my brothers, with that journey was like transitioning to this next chapter. So I related to the character in that way. And then, you know, I think I view a lot of responsibility. You know, I've had the honor of meeting so many incredible men and women throughout my journey as an entertainer who have said that just my openness and willingness to accept all people and all things has helped them be okay with who they are. I think one of those things, we had to approach it with a lot of love and a lot of care. And talked to a lot of my gay friends about their journeys and
gay friends, let's talk about them.
Well, I'm a theater boy, so. But yeah, I talked to them about that and kind of the best way to approach approach this, and it was great just to get to really dive in and tell the story as honestly as I could.
You know, what was your guys' first exposure to gay life growing up? Like, what your childhood is like, what was your, like, what do you first remember knowing what being gay meant? Did you have a gay friend? Did you have a gay uncle? Like, what was your, like, intro to homosexuality class?
Well, I grew up in Georgia, so it wasn't, all over the place where I was, but I have a gay aunt, so I always knew she was gay.
Everyone's gay.
Everybody's got a gay aunt, yeah.
Funky,
weird. Yeah. And then just once you got into high school, you knew. You know, but it still wasn't like, it took really until college where I was around a lot of people who were full on open.
Where'd you go to college?
University of Georgia.
Oh, wow.
Go to Bulldogs.
Or just like letting them shoot out there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, what about you, man?
I started doing this in New York when I was 8 years old.
Oh, wow.
I remember basically just being around so many incredible people who are so passionate about their work. And one of my friends, who was one of the guys that showed him, was Mark, was leaving the theater one day, and I saw him leave with his partner. And I looked at my dad and said, oh, that's different. And he was like, it's all love, it's all the same. And I was like, oh. It just connected with me immediately. And I came from a pretty religious background. I was actually a pastor. But he's an incredible man with an amazing open mind and heart, and it was the best summer I could have thought of. So.
All of a sudden, that one person in the yard, you're like, that's not weird for you. You're like, okay, it's on. And then that's it. That literally is like how you like erase a potential lifetime of cake. Someone's just like, no, that's fine. You're like, okay, cool. Well, I mean, now you're sort of like a low-key gay icon. He is! What? Like, me? Like, is that weird to you or overwhelming? Like, I mean, like, what's that like? I mean, you went from purity rings to Congress,
basically. It's highly treatable. Yeah, I mean, it's the bad thing. I don't own that title myself. That would be very strange, by the way, just because.
No, but you're just like, pigeonous, actor, singer, gay
icon. Yeah, but I mean, I'm honored. I mean, it's a joy for me to be able to be in the position, in as far as being a musician and an actor that can talk about these things and really be, and that's how I feel. But I don't really think about the whole gay.
Did you guys both celebrate the Supreme Court gay marriage ruling?
Yes.
Did you drink some rosé?
Tons of rosé. We did drink a lot of rosé together.
We were talking about the Supreme Court. There was a lot of rosé talk. Everybody loves rosé. Yeah. We're going to come out in the closet about that right now.
It's summertime.
Yeah. Rosé. It's summertime. Yeah. It's really, it goes down so easy.
It does.
It's water.
I love it. But then things we did acknowledge that things can get dark.
Very dark.
Yeah. So, like, what is your guys' relationship like? Because having hung out with you in the green room, you guys seem to be like bros.
Like, yeah, bro down.
Yeah.
Oh. We connected pretty quickly, actually. Once he finally accepted me.
I'll never leave him.
Once he let me be in the show, she said. We ran in there, we talked about character and life, and pretty immediately there was a friendship beyond the work that we were doing, and we've had a chance to know each other over the last year and a half, and go on some fun trips and hang out, and there is a thing that happens when you work on a show, it's personal and it's intense as this one. Were you asking, is it dark on set all the time, is it heavy? And it can be. You need those lunch breaks, 20 minutes here and there, to talk to somebody and just kind of get your mind off of the weight of the show. And Byron's vision for this is incredible, and as a friend, he's one of the best. So I think it's a good thing, and we are bros.
Thanks, buddy.
Oh.
Yeah, look, Nick and I hit it off. We have a lot in common. We're similar in certain ways that it allowed us to find some common ground that we're both in.
So. Do you have any input in your character, or do you ever collab at all, or are you just like, I love this, and then it's
No, we always talk. We're going to go have dinner the next couple of days to start talking about the next episodes, because I like to hear what Nick and all the cast, they're the stewards of their characters, and they guard them and look after them. So, I always like to hear what's in their head and where they feel like they want to go, or where they feel like the story's going, and then I take all that in and come up with the stuff. And then we talk about the scenes and storylines.
That's good, because as a showrunner, it's your job to create the atmosphere on set, so the fact that you've created something so supportive and loving is pretty big, because, I don't know how many showrunners on set, actually.
Yeah, and I really think that once you get on set, it's about Nick and the other actors, so I try to keep the environment on set open to discovering all that kind of stuff.
So season two, so you guys are writing, you're doing it now, you're filming now, okay. Nick, your character ended on a cliffhanger note, I'll say.
Yes.
There was a BJ moment. Yes! You know, no spoilers, whatever, but can you, paint me a gory watercolor of, what we're gonna expect? Is that just the tip? Or is it a full penetration?
To be honest, it's just beginning to unravel that part of the storyline. We're five or six episodes at the moment, and it's just kind of coming undone. And again, for the audience, the way the show's written, which is great, is that you're never sure, in the same way that he's not really okay with what's happening in his life at this moment. So I'm sure that'll continue to develop, and Byron speaks to it more than I can at the moment, but it is going to go there, I'm sure.
Well, man has needs. So. But we know how many episodes we have ahead of us, and it's a story that goes. It's a deep internal struggle, and it's very difficult, I think, for this character to accept and embrace parts of himself that he feels are going to recontextualize his relationships. Fair or not, that's the world he's living in.
Yeah.
Does it ever make you nervous, Nick? I think about, when I was hiring a show, where they're like, kiss a girl, I'm like, please, no! I'm just, nervous in terms of the idea, you're going, just, the material and the weight,
Yeah, it's an incredibly important story. I think that's the way I view it, on all levels. This world, the anime world, is like Byron said, can be very macho, and acceptance isn't the first word that comes to mind. And so I think it's important for us to tell it in a way that gets us there. I'm willing to go on the journey wherever it takes me. I'm committed to this character and this story, and it's going to be a ride, I'm sure.
Just want to know that I'm committed to. And I'll go wherever you go.
Okay.
What do you find to be the most difficult part of acting?
Most difficult part? I think that for me, the most difficult part can be in finding a way to make words your own. Because obviously you're playing somebody else and you're living that life, but sometimes words can get caught coming out of your mouth that don't feel natural or organic. So it's really important, like we were talking about before, to have that collaboration where we can find things to adjust and put it in your own voice within the words of character, so that when it comes out of your mouth, it feels real and authentic. I strive towards that. It's kind of been the thing I've worked the hardest on. And also just saying the work and being present. And, I started in theater, so it's a lot broader. And I've tried to take that down to a way more personal, sort of intimate setting for a film, and that's been
So what does music give you versus acting? What does music fulfill inside of you, and what does acting fulfill inside of you?
Music, it's been a part of my life, my world, since I can remember being in my mind.
Your life has it? I don't think so.
My dad, played the piano and sang, and so grew up in that musical environment, and was never pushy about it, but really encouraged that. And the acting was something that came from the theater experience and learning from that. And then over time, my brothers and I did some projects that didn't necessarily stretch our acting muscle, but it was more kind of stand there and say that and smile. So it was that. So to actually dig in and work with some great directors pushed me to be better. Was great. And so I think, I love both, and when people ask me to choose one, it's like, I can't. And the great thing is I don't have to. That's the beauty of the situation, and I'm thrilled about that.
And, this question is for both of you. I guess, what kind of stories would you remember for telling? What kind of mark, say you die tomorrow. You're not going to die tomorrow. God, calm down. Jeez. What do you kind of remember about? What do you hope to be doing with what you're doing? The telling stories and all that stuff.
So it's good. We do a show that feels truthful and entertaining and can reflect people's lives and struggles back onto them, and that people find some thread in there that can either just entertain the shit out of them or make them understand part of their life a little bit more, or just not feel like they're the only, lunatic suffering.
Yeah, I think, if I had some of what I would be remembered by, it'd be tough, because I view my experience in the acting world so very, very early, and I'm trying to find the projects that I'm drawn to. But I would hope the same thing, that it's quality material, but also that challenges people's way of thinking. Whatever the project is, it makes you think, blows the conversation, and pushes things in a positive direction.
Awesome. Well, I think you guys are doing just that, so that's good. I think we're going to open it up for a Q&A. Otherwise known as a Q&A. There's a man in the audience, if you just like file up behind him, like single file, line style, I feel like he's like a crazy teacher, you can ask a question to make it better. So come on down.
Can we fix that? This is beautiful, by the way. You should be so proud.
Oh, boys, that we're on home. Okay, I didn't realize we just popped up. First of all, I wanted a two-part question. One is, how challenging was this to go from a transition from, let's say, Disney Channel to DirecTV and Kingdom? And the second part of the question is, I work with ABC TV to produce pediatric issues here in Los Angeles, and we're putting together an anti-bullying campaign called Never Bully at Work with Marley Matlin, who and we were just wondering if you'd be willing to be a supporter. Just to be listed as a supporter for the campaign, because with gay issues and LGBT issues, that bullying is a big part of all of that. And I think what your show is doing is gaining acceptance. And I just couldn't help but ask, I don't know any personal business contacts you have.
Yeah, let's talk after. We'll talk about that. But I'll answer the first question over here. Transitioning from Disney to DirecTV, I mean, a huge jump, like I mentioned before, but I went from standing in the right spot in my marketing, delivering my line with a smile on my face, to material that's much more intense and kind of requires a lot of me emotionally and physically. But the thing you can say about Disney is that they do a great job of installing a work ethic in their talent, and that's what I took away from all of it is the opportunity to see the world, to be a part of some projects that challenged me, and I learned how to work and how to do a job, which is incredibly important once you become an adult.
Hi, my name is Dean, and I'm very nervous. But first, I want to thank Nate for just being embracing and supporting and doing everything for the LGBT community. And I'm sure I can speak for a lot of people, but I'm 50. There was no one like you when I was a teenager, so the fact that this younger gay generation can, be okay with, admiring a teen heartthrob and know that they, you know, support or support their well-being just really mean a lot. So thank you. I don't have DirecTV. Would there be a way for people to see the show that don't have DirecTV?
Yes. very shortly, and by the end of summer at some point, it'll be available on iTunes and other places like that. So it'll be available to all the members.
I'm going to say what Dee said. My name is Mark, and thank you, Nick, for a joke inside of me. Mr. Jones, for probably doing it for you, too. And I actually want to ask, can you explain to us a little how making a show for DirecTV fits into the media landscape? Because it's just so new to everybody, the Amazon and the Netflix, and DirecTV is a great place to be right now. And what does it mean, you know?
Well, yeah, you're right. It is it's overwhelming how many places are making content right now, and it's fantastic for people creating content. So, you know, with DirecTV, it's an amazing place to be because they know to survive, you have to have great, it's about having great material as opposed to trying to make, as I was saying earlier, a sort of broader, flat, mass appeal kind of thing, which is so much more of a niche world right now, just in music and TV and movies and all that kind of stuff. So it's an outstanding place to be, and the challenge is just cutting through all the noise and getting people to see it. That's always the hard part, but if you do make a good show, I really do believe people will enjoy find it. So, anyway, it's an exciting time, it's a great time, it's a wild time, and I'm certain to feel lucky to be able to make a show right now.
What I love about this role and your upcoming role on Scream Queens on Fox, it's so different. So, was there any overlap in the shooting schedules that, you know, made it kind of difficult to go into this dark place, into this sort of like, can't be put in place, and even if there was a direct overlap, how was that comparison?
There wasn't really an overlap schedule-wise, but certainly in the approach to the characters, and the tone of the show, this is darker and heavier, and there are some lighter moments, you know, there's a lot of comedy in the show, and even comedy in some of the turmoil, you know. But with Scream Queens, it's a very different tone, and Ryan Murphy does an amazing job that curates the look and vision for his shows, and they're always pretty incredible. And so I'm thrilled to be a part of that. Can't really say too much about my character, because it's, he's very tight about the storylines and stuff, but it's great to have both sides, you know, something that is straightforward comedy and brighter in that way, and having something that's grittier and darker, and I'm honored to be able to do both.
Hi, thank you for coming. I was wondering, you talked a bit about MMA fighters, and how there aren't a lot of out fighters, or any, as far as we know. But there also just aren't a lot of out gay characters that are athletes on TV, and I was wondering if you could speak to the difficulties, if there were any difficulties with the process of getting a main or supporting character who's an athlete on television, what that was like.
Well, I don't know that do you mean the character, getting that character, being able to write for that character on television?
Like just being able to get him on the screen. I mean, was there any pushback with that? There's been a huge leap in the past 10 years with queer representation on television,
right.
But that's fairly new, especially in the sports world. So
yeah, absolutely no pushback whatsoever. I mean, I think people are really embracing this character and the storyline, and that it's a slightly different story than you do see on TV, in the sense that we really plan to show and are showing the extraordinary. It's harder for some people than it is others. Some people are in an environment or have a support system that's different than others, and so we really wanted to explore that and tell that in an honest way, even when it's not pretty or it doesn't feel necessarily celebratory, as much as it is real life and ultimately coming to this character's truth.
Now, as a diabetes educator, Nick, thank you for having your name out there as a role model for children and young adults with type 1 diabetes. Now, while you're shooting, maybe from the beginning, because the show has a lot of full physical exertion, do you have a problem with dealing with your insulin pump while you're shooting?
Yeah, for those who don't know, I'm type 1 diabetic. I was diagnosed at 13, so coming up on 10 years now. And yes, it's incredibly challenging. You know, just living with diabetes without physical exertion like that is tough as it is, but adding that on top of it makes it that much more complicated. Really, interestingly enough, one of our directors in the show, Michael Morris, he's a diabetic as well. He's very conscious of being on set and making sure my numbers are good. And you know, I have great tools that help me stay healthy. The biggest change was really just when I sort of gained all the weight last season and was in the gym quite a bit and changed my diet. I would just work with my doctor to figure that out, because going up 15 pounds in about 2.5-3 months can complicate things, so that disease. So yeah, it's very intense, but I'm in the best health I've been in, and you know, that's a great thing. But thank you for educating people about diabetes.
We're out on Outfest. Thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you.